أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على خير خلقه العبد المؤيد والرسول المسدد حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وصحابته المنتجبين صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة ويا عبرة كل مؤمن ومؤمنة يا مظلوم يا غريب يا شهيد كربلاء يا ليتنا يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ربنا أمتنا اثنتين وأحييتنا اثنتين فاعترفنا بذنوبنا فهل إلى خروج من سبيل صلوا على محمد وآل محمد A second for the love of Imams Al-Hasan Al-Hussein. A third for the love of Fatima al-Zahra with your loudest voices. The topic of Al-Raj'ah is a controversial topic, not just between Sunnis and Shi'is, but among Shi'i scholars themselves. The Raj'ah means the return. Al-Raj'ah means the return. This topic is of major controversy. It's been greatly debated. Sunnis have their view on this topic. Shi'i scholars have their view on this topic. And Shi'i scholars themselves, some of them, disagree on the meaning of al-Raj'ah. What does it mean? Is it real? Will it happen? Does it have sufficient proof in the Quran? Does it have sufficient proof in the narrations of the Ahlul Bayt? And this topic, unfortunately, has not been given enough scholarly attention, especially in the English world. There are various articles and books that have addressed this topic in Arabic, but not so much in English. What is al-Raj'ah? What is the return? When we say the return, what do we mean exactly by the return? This topic could be somewhat confusing. It could be new for some, while others might have a good background. Al-Raj'ah, according to Shiite theology, is the return of some good people who are dead, but they will return when Imam al-Mahdi ajjarallahu ta'ala farajahu al-sharif reappears. When Imam al-Mahdi ajjarallahu ta'ala farajahu reappears, two kinds of people, this is the meaning of al-raj'ah, two kinds of people will also come back with him. Come back from the dead. They were dead, they will come back to life. Who? The very good and the very bad. The very good amongst us of the believers, they will also return. And the very bad from the people throughout the generations, they will also return. The very best and the very worst. Why? Okay, they return. Now what? The goal of al-raj'ah, the return, is for the very good, for the very good people, the best of people, to seek vengeance and revenge from the very bad and from the worst, especially if there were enemies. Let me give you an example. We believe that after the return of Imam al-Mahdi ajjarallahu ta'ala farajah, Imam al-Hussein will also return. He will return along with his 72 companions. They will come back to life. And Yazid and his gang, those who fought Imam Hussein, they will also come back to life. And Allah Azza wa Jal will give the opportunity for Imam Hussein and his followers to take revenge from their killers, from their enemies. This is just one example of the very good and of the very bad. There are others, as you can imagine. Others include other imams, those who were oppressed, those who were extremely pious, very righteous, but they were oppressed. Allah will bring them back along with their oppressors, those who killed them, those who hurt them, and have the good doers seek vengeance and revenge from the bad. There are some who reject the idea of the return, of the raj'ah. They say this is nonsense, this will not happen, this is a Shi'i superstition, it's nonsense and it won't happen. The vast majority of Sunni scholars hold this opinion, that this will not happen. Shi'i scholars, the majority believe in al-raj'ah. They believe in the return. It might not be discussed as much. Perhaps for some of you this is new. It's not discussed as much. Why? Because it raises a lot of questions. It confuses some people. However, you know, certain things must be mentioned. They must be told. This exists in our books. This is one of our beliefs. And today we'd like to analyze it. We'd like to find proof and evidence for it. Should we believe in it or should we not believe in it? There are some Shi'i scholars that believe, you know, al-raj'ah, the return, is the return of Imam al-Mahdi. And that is something that everyone accepts. Even our Sunni brothers and sisters, they also believe in al-Mahdi. But the difference is, we believe that he's already born in the year 256. They believe that he will be born in the future. Or some of them believe that he is Jesus. Jesus, Isa alayhi salam, is the Mahdi. They have various opinions. Some of our scholars believe that the raj'ah, the return, is the return of Imam al-Mahdi. That's it. There are some contemporary scholars that contest this theory, the theory of al-raj'ah, that the very good and the very bad shall return. And they claim that it has no proof and no evidence, while those who argue for al-raj'ah, they have their arguments. Now tonight, my dear brothers and sisters, first of all, we'd like to examine, is al-raj'ah rationally possible? Number one, is it rationally possible? Because if it's not rationally possible, then why come and, you know, try to find proof and evidence and argue? Let's see, is it rationally possible or is it rationally not possible to have a second coming, to have a return? To have two kinds of people, the very good and the very bad, the very evil, will come back to life, and the very good will seek vengeance and revenge for their oppression from their enemies. Is this rationally possible or not? This is one. Two, is this idea compatible with the Quran? What does the Quran say about, you know, people who will live another life in this life? Not in the next. We're talking about in this life. Is it possible for a person to die and then come back to life again and die again and then be resurrected for the Day of Judgment? Is this idea compatible with the Quran or not? That's two. Number three, is there any proof and evidence for the raj'ah in the way that we believe in it? That the very good and the very bad will return, and the very good will seek vengeance from the very bad. Does this have any proof and evidence from the Quran? Number four, is there any proof and evidence from the narrations of Ahlul Bayt? What do the Ahlul Bayt have to say about this? Number five, what is the philosophy of the Raja'ah? What is the point? What is the purpose of the return? Number six, is it necessary and compulsory to believe in al-Raj'ah? What if it doesn't make sense to me? What if I'm not convinced? Will I be committing a sin if I don't believe in al-Raj'ah, the return? Or do I have to accept it the same way that, for example, I accept the prophethood of Prophet Muhammad and the Imam of Imam Ali alayhi salam? And number six, or number seven rather, who will be the first to return after Imam Al-Mehdi? We shall try to touch upon these points briefly without taking too much of your time. Tonight, Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. You know, a complicated topic like this requires a louder salawat. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Number one, is al-Raj'ah, the return, rationally and logically possible? Is it possible for someone to have two lives? To live, die, and then come back to life again, die, and then be resurrected on the Day of Judgment? Is it possible to come back again to life? Sunni scholars say this is not possible. Rationally, it is not possible for you to have a second life, for you to come back to life after death. How is that logically and rationally possible? The answer is that it is very much rationally possible. And it is very much logically possible. What do you say about resurrection? If you deny the raj'ah, the return, because it's not possible to come back to life after that, after death, then you might as well, you should deny also what? Resurrection, the Day of Judgment. Because what is resurrection on the Day of Judgment? It's coming back to life after death. So if this is not possible for you, you think it's not possible, then resurrection is also not possible. It is not, the Day of Judgment is also not possible. By the way, there are some that deny resurrection. They deny resurrection how? There are some philosophers, they say that al-ma'ad al-jismani is not possible. Meaning what? That bodily resurrection, physical resurrection is not possible. So does that mean that they deny resurrection and the Day of Judgment? No. They say we believe in resurrection, we believe in the Day of Judgment, but it's spiritual, it's not physical. Why? They say, well, because when we die, when we're buried, you know, we turn into what? We turn into sand and soil. That soil turns into plants and trees. And those plants and trees, they go into people's stomach, into an animal's stomach. So we essentially become part of an animal, and that animal gets slaughtered and is eaten by another human being, and that human being dies and gets... You see? So how is it possible that Allah will return us with our exact bodies? That's impossible. Because our bodies will be part of other bodies, either animals or other humans. Well, and obviously humans are animals. So how is it possible to be resurrected with these bodies? They say it's impossible. Thus, resurrection is only spiritual, not physical. And this is called al-ma'ad al-jismani. There are some that deny al-ma'ad al-jismani. There are some philosophers. Of course, we believe that it's possible. And in Surah Al-Yasin, in Surah Yasin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alludes to this point, that a person asked, how is it possible that when a person dies, when his bones have deteriorated, they've turned into sand, Allah will return him. وَضَرَبَ لَنَا مَثَلًا وَنَسِيَ خَلْقَهُ قَالَ مَنْ يُحْيِي الْعِظَامَ وَهِيَ رَمِيمٌ قُلْ يُحْيِيهَا الَّذِي أَنْشَأَهَا أَوَّلَ مَرَّةٍ. He will say, a man will say, how can these bones come back to life? How can a human being come back to life? The Quran says, say, the one who gave it life the first time will give it life the second time. Is that too hard? The one who gave us life the first time and created us from nothing. Right? He gave us life and he gave us this body. Is it hard for Allah to bring this body back alive again? Absolutely not. If it was easy the first time, it's easy the second time. Thus, الرجعة, the return is very much rationally possible. It's logically possible. If you accept resurrection, the day of judgment, and al-ma'ad al-jismani, and that we will be resurrected with these bodies, then you have no objection. You cannot have any objection to al-raj'ah. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. This is one. Number two, the idea of having a second life, to come back to life after death in this life, in alam al-dunya, not in alam al-akhirah. Meaning to live, die, and then come back to life again here, before the Day of Judgment, before Alam al-Akhirah. Is this possible? We said it's rationally, logically, it's possible. Does this conform to the Qur'an? Is it compatible with the Qur'an? What does the Qur'an say about this? When we read the Qur'an, because, you know, in order to test any theory, any Islamic theory, to see if any theory is compatible with Islam, we have to see if it's compatible with what first? The Quran. The Quran. You tell me anything. If you want to know, is it Islamic or non-Islamic, I'll tell you, let's come to the Quran. And let's see what the Quran has to say about it. Islam and democracy. Islam and pluralism. Islam and communism. Islam and so-and-so. Islam and human rights. Islam and women's rights. Islam... Let's come and see what the Qur'an says. The first test is the Qur'an. Let's see, are these theories compatible with the Qur'an or not? Now let's come and see, is the raj'ah, the return of the very good and the very bad, is it compatible with the Qur'an or not? When we read the Qur'an, we see that coming back to life is something very much possible in the Qur'an. The Qur'an tells us of many people that came back to life in this life after dying. The Quran is full of stories. Not one, not two, not three. It's full of stories. These are not ahadith by the Ahlul Bayt for some people to contest them. You know, if you don't accept the Ahlul Bayt, you're going to say, well, I don't accept your narrations. I'm not arguing with narrations now. Now, we're arguing with the Qur'an. Our evidence is the Qur'an. The Qur'an tells us of several people that came back to life after death. One, the Qur'an tells us about the story of Prophet Hizqil, in the Bible known as Isaacle. In the Qur'an known as Hizqil. أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِينَ خَرَجُوا مِنْ دِيَارِهِمْ وَهُمْ أُلُوفٌ حَذَرَ الْمَوْتِ فَقَالَ لَهُمُ اللَّهُ مُوتُوا ثُمَّ أَحْيَاهُمْ. The Quran says, do you not see those who left their city by the thousands, fearing death, and then Allah told them to die. So they died, and then He brought them to life. What is this story? There was a city that the residents of that city were from Bani Israel, Banu Israel. There was an epidemic. There was a major disease in that city, so people started fleeing. They started running away. They started fleeing death. Allah told them, if you're running away from death, I could get death to reach you. So Allah killed them. Allah made them die. Prophet Hizqiel, he came and he saw thousands dead, their corpses. He saw their corpses and their remains. They were there. So Prophet Hizqiel, he started thinking, you know, how did these people die and how will they be resurrected? How will these remains and corpses and skeletons and bones, how will they be brought back to life? Allah wanted to show Prophet Hizqiel. He brought all of them back to life. And this is mentioned in Tafsir al-Tabari, which is a Sunni source of Tafsir, and Tafsir al-Durr al-Manthur, and Tafsir al-Suyuti. These three sources, these books of Tafsir are Sunni books of Tafsir. They mention that these people were brought back to life. فَقَالَ لَهُمَ اللَّهُ مُوتُوا ثُمَّ أَحْيَاهُمْ He told them to die, so they died, and then He brought them back to life. This is one incident. Another incident that the Quran tells us is about the story of Musa alayhi salam, when a man was killed innocently and two tribes were about to fight because there was a feud between two tribes and an innocent man died from one tribe. That tribe was accusing whom? The other tribe, that you killed our man, and there was about to be a major war. So they came and asked Prophet Musa, that what should we do? You know, bring this man back to life. Let's ask him who killed you. Prophet Musa said, okay. Allah says, kill a what? A cow. Baqarah. Surah al-Baqarah. The longest surah in the Quran is mentioned, is named after this cow, this story. They came and asked, which kind of cow? So he gave, you know, Allah never told them which kind. He told them, kill any cow, slaughter any cow. But they kept on asking questions, and Allah gave them more details. You know, sometimes people make it harder on themselves. The more they ask questions, the harder Allah will make it. Right? So sometimes just don't ask questions. Someone tells you, do this, do it. Don't ask for details. How should I do it? How should I do this? How should I do that? Just do it like you're told. Right? Finally, they found the cow, that yellow cow that Allah told them. And yellow, I mean, where do you find a yellow cow? Finally, they found a yellow cow. They came, they slaughtered it. They bought the blood. They put it on the man's feet. The man came back to life. And he said, here's my murderer. He pointed to his murderer. They grabbed that man and they executed him. وَإِذْ قُلْتُمْ يَا مُوسَى لَن نُؤْمِنَ لَكَ حَتَّى نَرَى اللَّهَ This is another verse. فَقُلْنَا ضْرِبُوهُ بِبَعْضِهَا كَذَلِكَ يُحْيِي اللَّهُ الْمَوْتَى وَيُرِيكُمْ آيَاتِهِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ This verse refers to the story of Musa alayhi salam. What happened? The man came back to life. He was dead, he came back to life. So this is very much possible. Another story that pertains to Prophet Musa alayhi salam. When Prophet Musa, this is the third incident, Prophet Musa took his companions, Bani Israel, to meet Allah. Supposedly they were going to meet Allah. They were that ignorant, thinking that they were going to see Allah. Right? They told him, we will not believe in you unless we get to see Allah. This was Bani Israel. وَإِذْ قُلْتُمْ يَا مُوسَى لَن نُؤْمِنَ لَكَ حَتَّى نَرَى اللَّهَ جَهْرَةً Musa told them, okay, come with me. He took 70 of them. They went to the mountains. What happened? A major, what would you call it? Lightning. Major lightning, major storm, they all died. فَأَخَذَتْكُمُ الصَّاعِقَةِ وَأَنْتُمْ تَنْظُرُونَ You are watching, all of a sudden a major lightning, a major storm killed all of you. When they died, except Musa, Musa remained alive. Musa told him, said, Oh Allah, please bring them back to life. Because if I go back to the rest of Bani Israel, they will say what? You killed them. They will accuse me of murder. So bring them back to life. Allah answered the dua of Musa and he brought them back to life. ثُمَّ بَعَثْنَاكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَوْتِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ Then we brought you back to life after your death so that you may be thankful. So that you may be thankful. This is in clear, plain Arabic. It doesn't need translation. Anyone who knows Arabic will understand that these people came back to life after death. Right? This is the Quran. In another incident, fourth incident, the story of Uzair and the Holy Temple. أو كالذي مر على قرية وهي خاوية على عروشها قال أنا يحيي هذه الله بعد موتها فأماته الله 100 عام ثم بعثه قال كم لبثت Prophet Uzair or Armiya, Prophet Armiya. Narrations say either Uzair or Armiya. One of them passed by the Holy Temple in Jerusalem that was destroyed by whom? By, in Arabic, Nebuchadnezzar, in English, Nebuchadnezzar, right? The famous king in Iraq. He came and he destroyed the Holy Temple in Jerusalem, the Holy Temple of the Jews. Uzair or Armiya, he came, he passed by the Holy Temple and it was destroyed, right? That's why the Jews, they have the weeping wall, wailing wall. Why? They wail for the destroyed temple. The temple that they believe was built by Prophet Sulaiman, Solomon. Anyhow, Uzair, he came, he saw the destroyed temple, the holy temple, it's destroyed. So he thought to himself, this place is in ruins. How is it possible that it could ever be, you know, reconstructed? It could be brought back. Allah makes him die. Allah made Uzair or Armiya die, and then he brought him back to life. He was asked, how long were you gone for? He said, a day or 2 days. قَالَ يَوْمًا أَوْ بَعْضَ يَوْمٍ I was gone for either a day or 2 years. A day or 2 years. بَلْ Then he is told, بَلْ لَبِثْتَ مِعَةَ عَامٍ You died for 100 years. For 100 years, and then you came back to life. It's very much possible for someone to die and then come back to life. Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. This is the fifth example. Prophet Ibrahim asked Allah, قال ربي وإذ قال إبراهيم ربي أرني كيف تحيي الموتى. Ibrahim asked Allah to show him how he will resurrect the dead. قال أولم تؤمن. Oh Ibrahim, you don't believe that we could bring back the dead? قال بلا. He said, I do believe. ولكن ليطمئن قلبي. I do believe, but I want to be rest assured. I want to be sure. I want to be positive. You know, sometimes when you believe in something, logically you believe in it, it's possible, but your heart, it needs reassurance, right? Your heart needs reassurance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Ibrahim, okay, get four kinds of birds, a peacock, a crow, a pigeon and a dove. Get them, slaughter them, cut them into pieces, mix them together. Mix the four different kinds of birds, mix them together. قال فخذ أربعة من الطير فصرهن إليك ثم اجعل على كل جبل منهن جزءا. Get these four birds, cut them into pieces, mix them together, and then divide them into 10 parts. And put every part on 10 mountains, 10 hills, right? And then call the peacock, call the dove, call the pigeon, call the crow. Someone is paying attention. And they will come back to you. ثُمَّ ادْعُوهُنَّ يَأْتِينَكَ سَعْيًا وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. And indeed, Ibrahim, he called one by one. He called the peacock came together. He called the dove came together. He called the crow, he called the pigeon, they all came back together. Life after death. This is life after death, and this life before the next. And finally, there's a lot of examples. I'm just giving you some. Prophet Isa alayhi salam. وَأُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. Prophet Isa alayhi salam, one of his miracles was what? To bring back the dead. To bring back the dead. That is why some people thought that he was God. Because of such miracles. Because of such miracles that people thought he was God. Even Imam Ali alayhi salam. Imam Ali alayhi salam, there were some people that thought he was God. They claimed that he was God. Why? Because he performed certain miracles. Rasulullah tells Imam Ali, halaka ya Ali, halaka fika thnan, muhibbun ghal wa mubghidun qal. He says, ya Ali, two people will be punished because of you. I mean, not because of you, but because of their position from you. One is a mughali, the one who declares that you're God, he'll be punished. Because this is kufr, this is disbelief. And another who hates you so much, who considers you a kafir, he will also be punished. You know, subhanAllah, Imam Ali, there's two extremes when it comes to Imam Ali. There were some that declared him God, and there were some that declared him a kafir. Anyhow, Prophet Isa would bring back the dead. So it's very much possible. Now, Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Life after death in this life, we saw that according to the Quran, is it impossible or is it possible? It's possible. We saw that there were various individuals or groups that were brought back to life in this life before the next. They lived twice and they died twice and then they were resurrected. Right? We saw this in the Quran. Now, but you might say, this is not enough to prove to me al-raj'ah, that the very good people and the very bad people will what? Will be brought back, will be resurrected in this life, and the good people will seek vengeance from the bad. Now I say, let's take a step further. Now we saw that coming, the return, coming back to life is possible. Let's try to find some proof and evidence from the Quran for the raj'ah. Now come with me. In one verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states, وَيَوْمَ نَحْشُرُ مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ فَوْجًا مِمَّنْ يُكَذِبُ بِآيَاتِنَا. In a day, we will resurrect from every nation a group. From every nation, we will resurrect a group from those who denied our signs. Meaning those who disbelieved in our signs. Some scholars say this is talking about what? Al-Raj'ah. The return. This is not talking about the Day of Judgment. Because most scholars, Sunni scholars, they say this verse is talking about whom? About what? The Day of Judgment. وَيَوْمَ نَحْشُرُ مِنْ كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ فَوْجًا. Some of our scholars say this verse is talking about Al-Raj'ah, not the Day of Judgment. How? Because it says we will resurrect from every nation a group, only a group. While on the Day of Judgment, everyone is resurrected, not a group. You see? وَيَوْمَ يُنْفَقُ فِي الصُّورِ فَفَزِعَ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Regarding the Day of Judgment, Allah says, when the day that person blows in the horn, everyone will be resurrected. That's the Day of Judgment. But this verse says that a day will come from every nation, a group will be resurrected. That group are those that are the very bad, the most evil. This is one verse. If you can test this verse, you say, you know, it's not very convincing. There's another verse. Let's see. كَيْفَ تَكْفُرُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَكُنْتُمْ أَمْوَاتًا. Pay attention. Follow up with me. Allah says, how can you reject? How can you not believe? While, how can you reject Allah and not believe? While, وَكُنْتُمْ أَمْوَاتًا, you were dead. فَأَحْيَاكُمْ, he gave you life. ثُمَّ يُمِيتُكُمْ, then he takes away your life, makes you dead. ثُمَّ يُحْيِيكُمْ, then he brings you back to life. ثُمَّ إِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ, then you will return to him. How many lives is that and how many deaths? That's two lives and two deaths. And then we return to him. You see? كَيْفَ تَكْفَرُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَكُنْتُمْ أَمْوَاتًا, you were dead, and then he gave you life. You were dead, meaning you were not created. He gave you life. فَأَحْيَاكُمْ, ثُمَّ يُمِيتُكُمْ, then you will die. ثُمَّ يُحْيِيكُمْ, then you will come back to life. ثُمَّ إِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ, and then you will return to him. Again, meaning what? You will die. That means two lives, two deaths. This is talking about al-raj'ah. If you can test, if you say no, we were dead, and then Allah brought us back to life, and then we die, فَثُمَّ أَحْيَاكُمْ ثُمَّ إِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ, then he gave you life, then to him you return. That means this is talking about the day of judgment, not another death. If this verse is, you know, not so clear, we have another verse. رَبَّنَا أَمَتَّنَا اثْنَتَيْنَ وَأَحْيَيْتَنَا اثْنَتَيْنَ, oh Allah, you gave us life twice and you made us die twice. Well, if you can say gave us life twice, that could mean gave us life in this life, and then he'll give us life when? On the Day of Judgment. Okay. But you made us die twice. How do you explain that one? قَالُوا رَبَّنَا أَمَتَّنَا اثْنَتَيْنَ وَأَحْيَيْتَنَا اثْنَتَيْنَ, you made us die twice and you gave us life twice. Well, we die once. Where's the other death? That's in what? Al-Raj'ah. Of course, this is not for everyone. Al-Raj'ah, the return is not for everyone. I don't know. Will I return? I don't know. Will you return? I don't know. We will mention that it's the only very good and the very bad. In another verse, there's a verse that says, إِنَّا لَنَنْصُرُ رُسُولَنَا وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَيَوْمَ يَقُومُ الْأَشْهَادِ, we will support our prophets and those who believe in this life. We will support them in this life. Our prophets, many of them, they were killed. They were oppressed. Prophet Zakaria, he was cut in half. Prophet Yahya, his head was cut and sent to a tyrant, very similar to whom? Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Imam Hussein says, me and Prophet Yahya, we have a lot in common. I mentioned a couple of days ago that Bani Israel, in some days, from dawn till sunrise, they would kill how many prophets? Who remembers? 70 prophets they would kill. The verse says, we will support our prophets in this life. How are they supported? How was Prophet Zakaria supported? How was Prophet Yahya supported? How was our prophet supported? How was Imam Hussein supported? All these prophets that were killed, how were they supported? You know, to support means to avenge, to give vengeance, to give that person the ability to revenge, to get revenge. Our scholars say this verse is talking about what? Al-Raj'ah, the return. These prophets will come back to life, and along with their killers, along with their enemies, and they will be able to seek vengeance. They will be able to take revenge. Some might say, you know, some might contest this verse as well. Some might say, well, to support doesn't necessarily mean, you know, to kill their oppressors, or, you know, to slaughter them or to kill them. No. Imam Hussein alayhi salam, the millions that remember Imam Hussein during these days, the millions who will walk to this grave, to his shrine, isn't that supporting the Imam? Isn't that Allah's support for Imam Hussein alayhi salam? That's better than having Yazid come back to life and kill Yazid, isn't it? Which one is really support for the Imam? The millions who walk to the Imam and are inspired by the Imam, or to kill Yazid? Thus, there are some who can contest this view. However, there's a narration by the Ahlul Bayt, by Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, regarding this verse, إِنَّا لَنَصُرُ رُسُلَنَا وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. The Imam says, this is pertaining to al-Raj'ah, the return. Because many prophets were killed, they were massacred, they were hurt, but they were not supported. They'll be supported in the second coming. And incidentally, in Sunni books of tafsir, they mention this. For example, in Tafsir al-Kashaf by Az-Zamakhshari, which is a very authentic book of tafsir for them. They teach it in their houses. It's taught in Al-Azhar, Al-Azhar University. They teach this tafsir, Tafsir al-Kashaf. He says, وَيُتِيحُ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَقْتَصُ مِنْ عَدَائِهِمْ وَلَوْ بَعْدَ حِينٍ. He will allow Allah, how does He support His, those who believe in the prophets? He will get someone to seek vengeance for their death from those who kill them. That means those people will come back to life and they will seek vengeance. Now this is all pertaining to the Qur'an. If you have some doubt, if you believe that these verses are not too convincing, I'm still not convinced, we come to the narrations of Ahlul Bayt. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. We have over 200 narrations by the Ahlul Bayt that talk about the Raj'ah, that talk about the coming, the return. 200 narrations by over 40 narrators. These 200 narrations, they're not all by one narrator, one or two or three, so that you may say, you know what, these narrations are not reliable. We've never heard of the Raj'ah before. This is nonsense. There's over 40 narrations. Over 40 narrators. These people couldn't have conspired all together to come up with such a theory. At various generations, during various generations at times, that narrate regarding al-Raj'ah. There are several scholars throughout history, in the history of Shi'ism, that wrote about al-Raj'ah. Ahmad ibn Dawood al-Jurjani, al-Hasan ibn Ali ibn Abi Hamza al-Bata'ini, who might not be such a reliable narrator according to scholars, but there's others. Al-Fadl ibn Shadhan, who's a very reliable scholar and narrator. He has a book on al-Raj'ah. Al-Shaykh al-Saduq, al-Ayyashi, these all have books on al-Raj'ah that prove al-Raj'ah will occur. There's so many narrations. I'll just recite to you some of them. Imam al-Baqir alayhi salam says, أَيَّامُ اللَّهِ ثَلَاثَ. There are 3 days, the days of God. يوم قيام القائم, the day that al-Mahdi will return. وَيَوْمُ الْكَرَّةِ, the day of the return, when the good and the bad return. وَيَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ, and the day of judgment. Imam Sadiq alayhi salam says, أَنَّ الرَّجْعَ لَيْسَتْ بِعَامَّةِ وَهِي خَاصَّةِ. The second coming, the return, is not for everyone. It's for only a designated group of people. وَلَا يَرْجَعْ أَلَّا مَنْ مُحِّظَ الْإِيمَانُ مَحْظًا. The very, very good, the very righteous, the very good believers, they will return. وَمَا أَوْ مُحْظَ الشِّرْكِ مَحْظًا. Oh, those that are very bad and very evil. So the very bad and the very evil, they will come back. The verse, إِنَّ الَّذِي فَرَضَ عَلَيْكَ الْقُرْآنَ لَرَادُكَ إِلَى مَعَادٍ. He, the one that revealed the Qur'an to you, will return you. The apparent meaning of the verse is that he will return you back to Mecca, because this verse was revealed when the Prophet was leaving Mecca to go to Medina. He will bring you back. The Imam says, may Allah bless Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari, the first to visit Imam Hussein. Why? Because he knew the real meaning of the verse. He will bring back the Prophet. He will bring back the Prophet, not to Mecca. He will bring him back to what? To life. He will bring him back to life. We see the concept of al-raj'ah in many of the ziyaras. The ziyaras that we recite for the Ahlul Bayt, we see that the raj'ah plays a major role. For example, in al-ziyara al-jami'ah, the very long ziyara that is for all of the ma'sumeen, that is narrated by Imam al-Hadi, we see that the raj'ah plays a major role. وَجَعَلِنِي مِمَّنْ يَقْتَصُ آثَارَكُمْ وَيَسْلُكُ سَبِيلَكُمْ وَيَهْتَدِي بِهُدَاكُمْ وَيُحْشَرُ فِي زُمْرَتِكُمْ. The dua says, O Allah, I want to be among those that will come back, that will live another life with the Ahlul Bayt, to see the Ahlul Bayt again. ويكر في رجعتكم ويملك في دولتكم. In زيارة الأربعين and in زيارة وارث. You know, sometimes we recite these statements and we don't know what it means. That's a shame. That's a shame. One of the sections in زيارة وارث and زيارة الأربعين, أشهد أني بكم مؤمن وبإيابكم موقن. What is إياب? إياب means your return. I believe in your return, you the Ahlul Bayt, that you will return. We believe that our Imams will return after the return of Imam al-Mahdi. They will all come back, one by one. And they will seek vengeance from their enemies. Right? In Ziyara al-Rajabiyya, the one that is recommended to recite in Rajab. حَتَّى الْعَوْدِ إِلَىٰ حَضْرَتِكُمْ وَالْفَوْزِ فِي كَرَّتِكُمْ. Now, after all of this, what is the purpose of al-raj'ah? You might say, well, okay, now you prove to us from the Qur'an and the sunnah from the narrations of Ahl Bayt, but I don't get it. Why? Why is there a second coming? Why is there a return? Why are the Ahl Bayt going to return? Why is Imam Hussein going to return? Why are the very good and the very bad, are they going to come back to life before the Day of Judgment? Why? To answer, صلى الله على محمد وعلى محمد. You see, the raj'ah, the return, is a manifestation of Allah's justice. Why do we have the Day of Judgment? Why do we have the Day of Judgment? Because on the Day of Judgment is a manifestation of Allah's justice. The good doers will be rewarded, the evil doers will be punished. That's the Day of Judgment. The same idea belongs to al-raj'ah. The raj'ah is a manifestation of Allah's justice, where the very good doers, where the very good will come back and seek vengeance and revenge from the very bad. That's a manifestation of Allah's justice. We believe Allah is just. How can, you know, the companions of Imam Hussein die unjustly? Imam Hussein died such a cruel death without seeking vengeance for his death, without his enemies paying the price for it. They should pay the price for it in this life. If they don't, that means there's no revenge, there's no vengeance. So the whole point of al-raj'ah is divine justice, so that the very good can get their revenge from the very bad. Okay, you might say, well, then what's the purpose of the Day of Judgment? Why shouldn't that happen in the Day of Judgment? I thought that will happen in the Day of Judgment. For the very good to get their vengeance from the very bad on the Day of Judgment. Why in this life? Allah is just, we know that. But His justice could be revealed on the Day of Judgment. Why in this life? The answer. You see, when someone hurts you very badly, let's say someone spreads a rumor about you. Someone hurts your family. God forbid someone kills a family member of yours. Someone really hurts you, really, really hurts you. You want your revenge, right? You want your revenge, and you want it now. You want it now, you don't want to wait. You don't want to wait 30 years, 40 years. You don't even want to wait until the Day of Judgment. You want your revenge now. You want to see it with your own eyes. That's only fair. That would be justice. Nothing will make you as comfortable as seeing the person who hurt you punished now in this life before the next. I'm sure some of you, when someone hurts you and you want that person punished, you say, oh Allah, I want to see that person punished now. You don't want to wait till the day of judgment. You want to see it with your own eyes, because that will make your faith in Allah even stronger, because you see it in your own eyes. Right? That's justice. That's justice. But for the punishment to be delayed, you know, some people are not satisfied with that. Imagine if someone kills one of your family members, and that person should be executed, right? Eye for an eye, life for life. That person should be executed. The government says, yes, we'll execute him, but not now, 30 years from now, 40 years from now. That's not fair. Why? Because he killed someone young, and if he were to be executed 30 years from now, he's going to be what? He's going to be old. It's only fair that he also dies young. Plus, you want to see it yourself. Perhaps 30 years from now, you're not going to be alive. The parents of that victim might not be alive. They want to see it with their own eyes. That is justice. They'll say, we want to see the murderer of our son or daughter executed in front of our eyes. We want to see it here in this life. That is justice. You see? Some people want justice in this life before the next. Yes, on the Day of Judgment there will be justice, but they want to see justice here as well. You know, you might not understand this fully well unless you've been oppressed and wronged. If you've been really oppressed, really wronged, you'll understand the concept of al-raj'ah, that you want to see justice in this life before the next. You know, for the people of Iraq, for all the families that have victims that were killed at the hands of Saddam, you know, almost in every household in Iraq, especially in the Shia households in the south, in every house there's a martyr, there's a shaheed. Saddam left his imprints in almost every house. And sometimes in every house he took more than one martyr. One, two, three. You know, I know so many families, there's a couple of brothers that were killed. Couple, right? You know, when was the happiest moment in the lives of some of the Iraqis? When was the happiest moment? When they saw Saddam hung. When he was executed, that was the happiest moment for some. I remember some elders, I would hear them say, I ask Allah to keep me alive the day that Saddam dies. The day that Saddam is executed. Some people pray to be alive. You know, when you have your young son or some sons, my aunt, she has two sons that were killed at the hands of Saddam. Why? Because in the year 91, in the riots that took place in Karbala, they participated. And there were some spies that came and said, you know, they participated in the rallies. They were killed. They had young children, small children. This is just one family. I know so many families, maybe you know families, they were killed at the hands of Saddam. The day that they saw Saddam die, it was a happy day for them. That was justice. What was happier was the day that his two sons were killed. The day that his two sons were killed. That's divine justice. The same way that he took the children of people, Allah took his children. That was divine justice. For some people, that was happier, that was better than seeing Saddam die. Because they saw justice in this life. That proves to them that Allah exists. If you have, you know, if your faith is shaky, you're not sure, when you see it with your own eyes, that's divine justice. That's divine justice. That proves that Allah exists. One day Musa alayhi salam was standing on a mountain. Allah told him, there's a river, or there's a lake. Look at that lake. I just want you to look. SubhanAllah, Allah sometimes works in amazing ways. So Musa was looking at the lake. He saw a man come, a knight, riding a horse. He came, he took off his clothing, he bathed in the lake, and then he got up, he put on his clothing. His belt, he forgot it next to the river, and he left. He got on his horse and he left. Back then, you know, people didn't have wallets. Where would they keep their money? In the belt. Just like Hajj. For those of you that have been to Hajj and Umrah, you know the belts that we wear in Ihram? It's basically pockets where you keep your money. This person, he forgot his belt. He forgot his belt, which had his money in it, and he left. Moments later, a young man came to drink water from this lake. He drank water, and then he saw a belt. He opened it, he saw it's full of money. He took it and he left. A couple of minutes later, an old man came to also drink or bathe in this lake. Who returned that night? He returned to look for his belt. He came, he didn't see it. He asked the old man, he said, "Where's my belt?" He told him, "Which belt?" He said, "My belt, I left it here. You took it." He said, "I have no idea what you're talking about. I didn't see a belt." He said, "If you don't give me my belt, I will kill you." The man started swearing that, "I haven't seen your belt." The knight takes out his sword and he kills that old man. And he leaves. Musa said, "Oh Allah, what sort of oppression is this?" I forgot to say that Musa asked Allah to show him his justice. He said, "Oh Allah, I want to see your justice." He told him, "Look at the lake." After saying this, Musa said, "Oh Allah, I told you to show me your justice, not your oppression. What I saw was oppression. I didn't see justice." He said, "Ya Musa, take it easy. You don't know what happened. As for the knight, you know, when he left his money, that second man who came and took the money, that was his money. The knight had stolen it from him. But he wasn't able to get it from him because this is a knight. This is a soldier who has a sword, who has a weapon. And the other man couldn't take his money. So this was the best way to get him to get his money." He said, "Okay, well, what about the old man that died innocently?" Allah told him, "Ya Musa, you think he died innocently, but he didn't. Because this old man, 30 years ago, he killed the father of that knight innocently. After 30 years, we had his son seek vengeance for his father's death." That's justice. That's justice. See, people want to see justice. Sometimes when you see justice, you believe your faith in Allah is strengthened. Now, the belief in al-raj'ah, the return, is it necessary? Is it part of usul al-deen? Just like believing in tawheed, al-adl, al-nubuwa, al-imama, al-ma'ad, do you also have to believe in al-raj'ah or not? Is it part of usul al-deen or not? Is it a sin if you don't believe in it or not? We believe that we have sufficient proof for al-raj'ah. We have sufficient proof that it will take place, that it will happen, from the Quran and from the narrations of Ahlul Bayt. However, if a person is still not convinced, maybe you're still not convinced, maybe others are not convinced, you might be convinced, you might not be convinced. If you're not convinced, no, Allah will not punish you. Allah will not, it is not part of usul al-deen. It's not part of usul al-deen. It's not like tawheed and adl and ma'ad and nubu and imama. No. It's like, as in the words of Shaykh Muhammad Hussein Kashif al-Ghita, he says, as al-raj'ah is one of the things that will happen in the future. For example, the appearance of the Dajjal. If you deny the existence of the Dajjal because you don't have sufficient proof, is that disbelief? Will you be punished for that? No. Or believing some of the signs of the return of Imam al-Mahdi. Do you have to believe in them? No. It's not a sin. If you're still not convinced, it's not a sin. It's not part of usul al-deen. Basically, it's not part of usul al-deen. And finally, we believe that the first person that will return after Imam al-Mahdi's return is Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Imam Hussein will come back with his 72 companions. Along with 70 prophets, they will come back and he will seek vengeance for his death, for his martyrdom, from those that killed him, from those that oppressed him, not just those who physically killed him and who were present in Karbala, but those who led to his death. Those who led to his death. And I know, and I think you know who I'm talking about. Those who paved the way for the death of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Those who paved the way for Ashura, they will also be punished. And Imam Hussein will seek vengeance. And when Imam al-Mahdi dies, when he will become a martyr, Imam Hussein alayhi salam will wash him and shroud him and pray over his body, and he will bury Imam al-Mahdi in his own grave, the grave of Imam Hussein. Karbala and the shrine of Imam Hussein will become the shrine of Imam al-Mahdi. And Imam Hussein will become the Imam, and he will be in charge. He will lead.